Hey folks, this is Best in Slot and welcome to the third of five videos we'll be doing on Prehistoric Planet Season 2, covering the show as it airs throughout the week, focusing on dinosaur design discussion, reviewing the scenes, talking about both the science on display and highlighting some of the fun camera trickery along the way. Today in episode 3 we'll be moving from the roaring heat of the Badlands and into the goopy soup of the swamps. We begin our journey in Northeast Asia, a low-lying territory flooded to create a huge collection of small islands. Due to that separate and small nature, they make for viable nesting grounds, and that takes us to our first animal for today's episode, a baby pterosaur, and that's darked to be a little bit more exact. It's not named by name, but based on an animal we'll see in just a moment, we're likely once again in Mongolia here, which means this tiny little lass is almost certainly a juvenile of the Mongolian giant, a so far unnamed Atstarkid which we may have also glimpsed in the previous Badlands episode. Fun fact about said Atstarkid, the only material we have for it is a single indeterminate bone discovered inside the gut cavity of a velociraptor. She is, and I know I make this point a lot about the young animals, lovingly animated, clearly unsure of herself as she topples back and forth, figuring out how the world and her limbs work. She even goes on a little test flight in the sanctuary of the island, though it ends about as well as you'd expect for a beginner. This leads to the reveal that she's not alone. There's a mini colony of these pterosaurs gathered on the island, but it can't sustain them, especially not at the huge 30-foot wingspan size they're going to eventually grow to. And that means they must take flight and try to make it across to the lush forests beyond the water. If you've seen season 1, you know where this is going. One of the group goes for it, launching itself across the open water, but unfortunately lacking the strength to make it all the way across. Brief moment here to commend the improved visuals on the water here as the pterosaur crash lands. It was one of the main things I was critical of in season 1, and while we do need to see tomorrow's ocean episode to really say for sure, they do appear to be vastly improved compared to the previous season. The little one awkwardly swims along as best as it can before a Shamosuchus suddenly appears from below, snatching it up and descending back into the depths as quickly as it arrived. There's no ominous music nor subversive triumphant music here, it's played entirely straight, and the only warning of impending danger is a low rumble a split second before the Shamo appears. It's a reflection of the brutality of the situation. Doesn't care how cute you are, you're still dinner. It turns out there's a whole group of the Shamosuchus here, and they're hungry. Shamosuchus is a Mongolian and Uzbekistan crocodiliform. It was first described back in 1924 by Mook, where he made the point that because the eye and nasal openings are not raised above the skull, as they are in modern crocodilians, this thing likely wasn't an ambush hunter. It couldn't sit still and be inconspicuous for long periods of time, as we see with modern crocodiles. Likely preferred hunting fish, mollusks, and yeah, maybe baby atstarkids with speed and brutality instead. I do have a little quibble here. The next shot shows us a Shamosuchus up close. That's a lot of S's, but it's very clearly a real crocodile instead, and it just doesn't match the Shamosuchus in the morphology, especially around the eyes, or the coloration. I really like the inclusion of real-world animals in this series, I complimented it back on the Islands episode, but here it sticks out a little bit too much, and I feel like the clip could have maybe been color-corrected at the very least so it matched a little bit more. Anyway, more pterosaurs try to make it across, some of them being snatched out of midair and some of them landing in the water before being dragged below. Again, the water effects near faultless, kudos. We then get some absolutely superb animation work as a Shamosuchus bursts out of the water to try and snatch one of the stragglers. She darts around, I like to think she's the one from the start of the episode, and she dodges the attack before hurling herself into the sky as the theme music triumphantly blooms. And the tone shifts and you know she's in trouble. Another Shamo tries to grab her, she tumbles to the water and begins to swim desperately as she's pursued onto land. At least affording us a closer look at this crocodiliform who is, as is common with the scalier creatures on the show, very, very believably rendered. She escapes though and Shamo walks off. In shame. Our Atstarkid, however, is triumphant and celebrates her newfound home by snacking on a lizard unfortunate enough to have crossed her most ferocious path. For our next segment, we're heading to South America and Argentina specifically. It's a busy, humming swamp teeming with life. I'd love a little more focus on arthropods in this series. Everyone else is getting their dues this time around, so a segment on the arthropods of the time would be really appreciated for me personally if season 3 ever comes to fruition. We descend into the murky water to see a gar. Attenborough here calls it a gar fish, which is not actually the same thing, and I'm pretty sure it's just a little mistake. Gars were found in the Allen Formation where this scene is taking place, and gar fish are pelagic, so it does the pee-pee thing where we think we're looking at the predator and suddenly it becomes the prey, snatched up by an ostroraptor. Now, I don't want to mention this again as we go through, so I'm just going to say it now, that while I really like the design of this thing, with its bands of varying shades of grey and bursts of crimson on some of them, I just couldn't find it believable for some reason. There's something about the eyes, or the lighting, or something that kept pulling me out of the scene. It's still wonderfully made and animated, and the sound design is fantastic. Can't say sounded, but it's one of the less convincing creatures in the series for me. It's still lovely, just worth noting. I do need to, you know, be fair where possible, and now I won't mention it again. It does stand up better, however, when the head is avoided, as you can see here in some beautifully realized feathers, spreading from curved wings down to a downy, furry underbelly. And as per usual with PP and Dromaeosaurid feet, they're remarkable. I said this about the Velociraptorine in season 1 and it holds true now as well. They're just incredibly lifelike thanks to superb animation and texture work in particular. Attenborough mentions how Ostroraptor was well adapted to fishing, and it likely was. They have conical teeth that lack serrations, actually very similar to Spinosaurids actually. It was also very likely a very fast and agile dinosaur, however, making it also well adapted to hunting small darting prey among busy forest and swampy foliage. They've gathered here in a group with the dominant ostros claiming the best fishing spots. They look pretty cool in some shots, okay? Anyway, with so many dinosaurs about, conflict is inevitable, and just like modern animals do, brown bears in particular are well known for it, they begin to spar over claim to the fishing spot. We're introduced then to a younger male, note the spurts of faded yellow colouring along his body, likely the colouring he more had as a true juvenile that he hasn't really grown out of entirely yet. But oh no, he can't get a good fishing spot because he's young and therefore distracted by Pokemon cards or something. He spots some goopy fish remains, scraps from a larger Ostroraptor, and he begins to sneak forward, hoping to get himself an easy meal. Attenborough says he'll need to be sneaky, and he says it with such joy. He just goes, he'll need to be sneaky. That was terrible, but leave me alone. He says it with such happiness and clearly fervor that I can't help but smile. Even at 97 years old, he can still hear those moments of pure love for the job through his voice, and we really need to appreciate him as a narrator while we still have him. Unfortunately, he just isn't sneaky enough, tumbling to the ground as he dodges the assault of the perturbed adult, and eventually careening off into the forest where he'll hide behind a tree, sheepishly poking his head out to make sure he's not being followed. I've warmed up a lot to the Ostro design as I've recorded this segment, but it's never a problem with anything else they do, because they're injected with so much personality thanks to their animation work. The juvenile has all the effect of a pet who knows it's done something wrong, so it's avoiding eye contact or hiding away in the laundry basket. Not that that'll stop him for long. I also adore the breathy little sounds they make as an aside. Very similar to the Herrerasaurus from Jurassic World Evolution 2, actually. These are hissy, almost strange sounding dinosaurs, and it feels appropriate for the kind of sleek form that they've got. Anyway, another adult approaches and the two wage war for the fishing spot, and the younger male sees his opportunity. The filming here is fantastic and apes the spider scene from episode 1. The music is ramping up, the two ostros are twirling around each other in this elaborate, almost dance-like combat, and the camera keeps zooming in several times on this dead fish. It's such a tonal switch, we've got vivid life and rotting death, and it feels like a moment of black comedy. The filming work in this season is leagues above season 1 for me personally. Our young male is successful, gets himself a fish and swallows it down whole with those juttering neck-like motions you would see in a stork or some other similar modern birds. For segment 3, we're leaving South America and returning once more to Madagascar for what is one of my absolute favourite, if not my favourite segments in PP history. In a lovely callback to season 1, we're once again with Machikasaurus, unfortunately with the bizarre teeth still covered up, as it jaunts down to a watering hole and Attenborough warns of a monster lurking nearby, Beelzebufo. When first shot, it's framed entirely through these real close-up shots, much in the way Godzilla, for example, is often filmed, the implication being that it's simply too big to fit in the frame of the camera. That, coupled with a few shots of looming shadows and haunting music, sell it as a beast to be feared. and then it plops its fat body into the frame and it's just this big slab of angry frog. It's threatening to Mashika, don't get me wrong, but it's a really fantastic contrast with the way they've styled the shoot. I can't show you actual animation from the show for these videos, probably, I think. But look, if you only watch one scene, watch this one. I already adore the Beelzebufo design from season 1, and now watching it drag itself, impossibly realistically, through the mud is a sight to see. It's doing so to take itself to a muddy pit of water, all part of its plan to attract a mate. He begins to bellow, causing reverberations to ripple out into the surrounding water, another wonderfully framed shot. A good pool is necessary to attract a mate, as we all know, and so he's picked out his prime location, one where the breeding and the spawning could also possibly take place afterwards. Unfortunately for Beelzebufo, the only animals attracted to his location are a small herd of Rapetosaurus, a titanosaur, and they're not noticing the little critter in their way. In an effort to not be stepped on, he plops his body to the side after a standing 45 degree hop and flings himself to safety across the mud. And that's what they're here for, mud. And whilst I'm unsure if there's direct evidence for dinosaurs doing this, seems like it'd be quite a difficult thing to get, it's such a common trait in large modern warm-blooded animals like, you know, elephants and rhinoceros, that it seems inevitable that larger dinosaurs would have done this same behaviour. This is typically done to remove parasites, but also to cool down your body temperature, no doubt helpful in the heat of Madagascar. Time is of the essence, however, for the Beelzebufo, because much like many modern frogs, they want to mate at the start of the rainy season, and if he doesn't make it to the new pool, he may miss his chance. Thus begins my absolute favourite sequence in all of PP history, beginning with our Beelzebufo tumbling head over heels off a tree branch with this ragdoll-esque flop. What plays out next is like a realistic rendition of prehistoric Frogger, as Beelzebufo hops his way bit by bit across the mud baths of the Rapetosaurus, avoiding stomping feet and swinging tails. It is physical comedy personified, and as an added bonus, he scares away at the end a curious Rapetosaurus who spotted him during his escapades. He is the devil toad, after all. He can't be heard above the call of the Rapetosaurus, who eventually do move on, leaving in their wake giant footprints to form pools that Beelzebufo can utilise. It's worth noting that Rapetosaurus, despite I've been focused so much on the devil toad, the Rapetosaurus sound and look fantastic, their animations in particular as they roll and almost frolic in the mud baths is really well realised. For our penultimate segment, we head to North America and the much heralded arrival of Pachycephalosaurus. The males, as seen here, are brightly coloured for display purposes, and the uncovered is actually focused on these Pachycephalosaurs, although they keep saying Pachycephalosaur, which I've never done this pronunciation, and now I'm paranoid I've been doing it wrong my entire life. To sum up the findings, it was a debate on whether they used the skull domes for combat or display. For a long time, it was combat, until evidence was found suggesting that A, the skulls were maybe too weak for combat, and B, a mesh of tiny fibres were discovered on the dome, perhaps able to support brightly coloured skin. This was then refuted by several different papers, most notably in 2013 when a paper by Peterson et al. Found evidence for headbutting in the pathology of multiple Pachycephalosauridae. So, all told, both are likely true, and it was probably used for both display and combat. As you can see, the females aren't as brightly coloured, the kind of sexual dimorphism we see constantly in the animal kingdom, but their skulls are still very elaborate in their spiking and spininess. This led some people to believe that these were Sticky Moloch or Draco Rex prior to reveal. The debate on this topic rages on, and likely will continue to do so for some time. But a paper in 2021 by Evans et al. Suggests that while Draco Rex is likely a juvenile, I used to say Dracorex, people kept saying it's Dracorex. Anyways, Sticky Moloch might instead be better placed as a new species of Pachycephalosaur, P. spinifer. Anyway, off topic. One little detail I like back here a lot actually in the scene is the Pachycephalosaur eating beetles off a log. Whilst they might prefer something else, fruits and leaves, etc., like most modern herbivores, they're not above going off menu. I say herbivores, but in 2018, a more complete skull for a Pachycephalosaur was detailed and revealed serrated front teeth to go along with the much flatter back teeth, typically reserved for vegetation. And that's a setup, you'll realise, very similar to our own. You've got your sharp canines, etc., and your incisors at the front, and then you've got your molars at the back. So that means Pachycephalosaurus was well set up for an omnivorous diet. There's likely some more twists to come in that story. Either way, a younger male has decided to be a bit of an upstart. Note the faded colouring compared to the older, more successful male, and thus begins our first round of Pachycephalosaurus combat. They rut and call out and scrape at the earth with their feet to try and impose themselves upon each other, basically a pre-fight weigh-in. But it's only going one way, and soon they're hurling themselves forward, colliding with visceral force into the head and body of their opponent. It's a really well-filmed fight filled with jump cuts and slow-motion shots and quick cuts to the females watching with their mouths agape, like it's a seedy dojo fight in some cheesy 80s movie. Shots like this in particular really sell the vibe, the camera flanked as it is on both sides by onlookers as though we ourselves are one of them, watching this wonderfully weighty battle play out before us. It seems as though the young male has won. A subversion of how the battle appeared to be going, he lets out a bellow of victory, as Attenborough calls it. And then the older male bursts in off-screen and catapults the challenger to the ground. There's a lesson to be learned here about cockiness and finishing the job, you know, that he clearly didn't learn from Game of Thrones. The young male is defeated and must leave behind the herd. As must we, as we move on to the final segment. For that, we must head to North America, everyone's favourite biome, and I joke, but this is a baller scene, it must be said. The music here is sumptuous and beautiful, and for a moment it really does feel like you're just watching nature unfold, as these Edmontosaurus and Triceratops live and graze together in harmony. As a bonus, my favourite dinosaur from season 1, my beloved gremlin Triceratops babies, also make an appearance, dashing around joyfully and playfully headbutting into each other. They are adorable, I love them, I want one. Unfortunately, the camera is here to play with your heart, and it pans slowly to the side to reveal not one, but two watching Tyrannosaurus Rex. I'm unsure if these are meant to be a breeding pair, siblings, or two strangers, but my feeling, given the near identical coloration, is maybe they're meant to be siblings, or at least family members of some description. Attenborough mentions they were ambush hunters, and there really is a myriad of studies supporting this. At the end of the day, the prey the Rex hunted as an adult was gigantic. Interesting to note that adult Rexes and young Rexes would have hunted different prey, and that way they don't compete with each other. Anyways, for example, Edmontosaurus is huge and pretty speedy. Triceratops is obviously well equipped to defend itself. A head-on attack on either is not that likely to be successful, and any injury could be death. T-Rex actually died fairly often at a young age because of the type of prey it had to take down. An apex predator then, to be an apex predator, must develop new strategies. Before that happens though, we must have this beautiful shot of the Triceratops trio on the riverbank, looking incredible in their array of crest colours and shapes and horn angle positions and the colours and everything. They're clearly the same species, but with some individualisation far above anything else we've seen in the series so far. Let me know your favourite, I'm curious. I'm leaning towards the middle, it looks brooding. Brooding enough to spook the Rexes away for now, but they'll be back at night. T-Rex, with its gigantic eyes and therefore superior nighttime vision, awakens in the midst of the night, painting them as, at the very least, intelligent hunters that know how to use their surroundings to their full advantage. There's a lovely moment of personality here as well, as the first Rex wakes up the second Rex with a nudge as though to say, you know, get up, I'm an alarm clock, it's time to hunt. Every movement and choice here in this scene is done to reflect the hunting capabilities and intelligence of these dinosaurs. We're back quickly then to the horror framing. Slow panning cameras, ominous drones vibrating in the background, the Rexes silently circling the resting and eating herd. There's even shots wherein the Rex isn't there, the Edmontosaurus raises its head, and when the Edmontosaurus lowers its head back down, the Rex is there waiting in the background, stalking and hunting. Again, that is horror film 101. How many times have you seen that exact same shot in like a slasher film or a ghost film or something? Side note, I adore horror films and that's why I keep bringing it up. It makes me happy. Then we get another dose of intelligent hunting. One of the Rexes makes a noise on purpose, luring the attention of the Edmontosaurus in one direction, while the other Rex sneaks around to the side, using the thick pads on its feet to conceal the sound of its movement. All of this is rendered in some beautifully shot nighttime footage that realistically blends CGI with real footage, one of the big benefits of nighttime sequences. And yes, it does very much have a Jurassic Park 1, clever girl kind of vibe to it. They spring the trap, the first T-Rex darting out from the woods and chasing down one of the herd. They tussle, the herd flees towards the other, waiting patiently Rex, aping very much the Velociraptor sequence as well from the Badlands, and the two of them chomp and drag and tear at the Edmontosaurus until it falls to the floor where they can deliver the killing blow. There's a real sense of weight and heft to the scene, these are gigantic dinosaurs after all, aided by some wonderful sound design, another aspect that's really gone up a level this season. Not only are these rexes incredibly built predators, but they've got the intelligence to collaborate and ambush at the right time together. If nothing else, you can see why they're the king. And that is the end of Swamps. I really enjoyed Swamps. If I had one minor criticism, I would have loved another 5 to 6 minutes. And then maybe there's a thing that the other two episodes have done where they've returned to a previous dinosaur. For example, we had the Icysaurus in the last video. We went back to the Icysaurus for a second round. And that kind of ties it all together nicely. It bookends the whole episode narratively in a really nice way. And this episode lacked that. And given the length of the next two episodes, I suspect they'll also lack it, but we'll have to wait and see. That's a little bit of a shame. I would love these episodes to be longer. You know, we've lost like 10 to 15 minutes from some of these episodes, which is a really long amount of time. Would love the scenes to have a little bit more room to breathe and, you know, one more scene in there potentially as well. Maybe going back to something else with the At Starkid when it's grown up, for example, something like that. I really enjoyed Badlands, but it wasn't my favourite of the three, so this was a nice return to form for me personally. And yeah, I really hope you all enjoyed it. Let me know what you think in the comment section down below. Throw me a like if you enjoyed the video. Subscribe for more PP and other dinosaur stuff. And of course, we will be back tomorrow with the Oceans episode. I'll see you lovely folks then. And thanks for joining me. Cheers much of as always. Bye-bye.